In this video, we'll study about the structures in relation to the suboccipital triangle. First, we'll study about the content of the suboccipital triangle. So, the main content is the third part of the vertebral artery. So, this is the third part of the vertebral artery and it appears in the suboccipital triangle through the foramen transversorium of the atlas, the first cervical vertebra. It winds backwards and medially behind the lateral mass of the atlas and it lodges in the groove on the upper surface of the atlas, the posterior arch of the atlas, where the dorsal ramus of C1 nerve emerges between the artery and the posterior arch of the atlas. From here, the dorsal ramus of C1 nerve enters. From here, the third part of the vertebral artery enters the vertebral canal by passing through the posterior atlanto-occipital membrane. So, this is the posterior atlanto-occipital membrane and after that it continues as the fourth part of the vertebral artery. In the suboccipital region, it forms a loop from the foramen transversorium. So, this loop serves to damp down the arterial pulsation within the cranial cavity. Here, the vertebral artery gives muscular branches to the suboccipital muscles and also the meningeal branches to the posterior cranial fossa. Now, we'll see about the vertebral artery. In short, the vertebral artery arises in the root of the neck from the upper surface of the subclavian artery, the first part of the subclavian artery. So, this is the first part of the subclavian artery and this vertebral artery is divided into four parts. The first part, so this is the first part of the vertebral artery from the origin to the foramen transversorium of the C6 vertebra. So, it does not passes through the foramen transversorium of C7 vertebra. So, it passes through the C6 vertebra. So, from the origin up to the foramen transversorium of C6 vertebra, it is the first part of the vertebral artery. And the part which passes from the C6 transversorium up to the C1 transversorium, so this is the second part of the vertebral artery. And the third part you have seen, so that lies in the suboccipital triangle. The third part of the vertebral artery lies in the suboccipital triangle and extends from the foramen transversorium of the C1 vertebra up to the posterior atlanto-occipital membrane. Here it forms a loop and lies on the groove over the upper surface of the posterior arch of the atlas. Then it passes through the foramen magnum. From here it continues as the fourth part of the vertebral artery and pierces the meninges and enters the cranial cavity, and at the lower border of the pons it joins with the opposite side vertebral artery to form the basilar artery. So the next content is the dorsal ramus of C1 spinal nerve. So this arises from the C1 spinal nerve and this dorsal ramus emerges between the vertebral artery and the posterior arch of the atlas and immediately divides into muscular branches to supply the rectus capitis posterior major, the rectus capitis posterior minor and the obliquus superior, the obliquus inferior and also the semispinalis capitis. The branch to the inferior oblique muscle joins with the greater occipital nerve and the C1 nerve does not have a dermatome as it has no cutaneous branches. So, the next main content of the suboccipital triangle is the suboccipital plexus of veins. So, veins and this lies in the suboccipital triangle and it collects the blood from the neighboring muscles, the occipital vein, the transverse sinus through the emissary vein, internal vertebral plexus and this drains into the vertebral vein. Now, Next, we'll see some of the structures in relation to the roof of the suboccipital triangle. So, the main content is the greater occipital nerve. So, this is derived from the medial branch of the dorsal ramus of the C2 spinal nerve. And this is the thickest cutaneous nerve in the body. And it winds around the lower border of the inferior obliquus muscle and crosses the inframedial part of the roof of the suboccipital triangle, and it pierces the trapezius 2 centimeters lateral to the ligamentum nuchae and becomes cutaneous and supplies the skin of the posterior part of the scalp up to the vertex. The next structure is the third occipital nerve. So this is the third occipital nerve. It is the medial branch of the dorsal ramus of the C3 spinal nerve, and it supplies the skin of the back of the neck up to the external occipital protuberance. The next structure we'll see here in the roof is the occipital artery. So the occipital artery arises from the external carotid artery. So this is the external carotid artery. It arises from the external carotid artery in the carotid triangle. Then it lodges, passes upwards and lodges in the groove in the mastoid part of the temporal bone, and it crosses the supralateral part of the roof of the suboccipital triangle. And in the suboccipital region, the occipital artery gives meningeal branch, mastoid branch, muscular branch, and descending branch. So this descending branch is important as it established the collateral circulation when the external carotid artery or the subclavian artery is ligated. So the descending branch divides into two, a superficial branch and the deep branch. The superficial branch anastomoses with the superficial branch of transverse cervical artery, and the deep branch anastomoses with the deep cervical artery. So this is how the collateral circulation is established if the external carotid artery or the subclavian artery is ligated. The clinical importance of the suboccipital region is the cisternal puncture. So this is done at the suboccipital region to collect the cerebrospinal fluid from the cisterna magna. In this, the needle is introduced in the midline just above the spine of the axis in a direction forward and upward, parallel to the imaginary line extending from the external acoustic meatus to the nasion. The needle pierces the posterior atlanta occipital membrane at 4 to 5 cm depth, and this is indicated by sudden loss of resistance and enters the cisterna magna. And too much insertion of the needle is fatal due to the injury of the vital medullary centers.